Hello friends, welcome to CEC Gurukul Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in this session we are going to continue further in our series on principles of ecology. Dear friends, today we are going to talk an important topic, and our topic of discussion is interaction in community. We are going to talk on predation in detail, and for the discussion on the topic we have with us in our studios Dr. Varunendra Singh Rawat. Dr. Varunendra Singh Rawat is Assistant Professor in Department of Zoology, Hindu College, University of Delhi. Dr. Rawat is a dynamic professor, and we are always delighted to have him in the studio. Through him, we get in-depth knowledge on various topics. Friends, while listening to us, if you have any question in mind, feel free to talk to us through our toll-free number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. I repeat, our number is 1-800-110-430. Now, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Varunendra Singh Rawat, once again, and would request him to give us in-depth knowledge on the topic. Hello, sir. Welcome to the
Thank
lecture.
You. So, without further ado, I would like to start with the topic, that is interactions in a community. And today, I'll be dealing with one of the subtopic, one of the very important interactions which occurs in a community, that is predation. So, after this lecture, you should be able to tell what are the different relationships which occur between predators and prey in a community, and what are the different responses of predator to prey population density. This will be the objective for today's lecture. But before moving on to different types of interaction, just for revisiting purpose or for revising, let me describe to you what exactly a community is. As in humans, you know, a community is basically described in the terms of either religion or ethnicity, but that is not the case in the wildlife, in the natural community. Whereas in the case of humans, we are dividing on in the terms of specific regions or religion. In wildlife, the community actually is an assemblage of different species. So if we refer to humans for community, we'll be wrong on that aspect, because in nature, the community is having more than one species at a given time. So in this particular picture, we can see there are different species, at least four species can be visualized here. And these all species together, when they are present in a given area, when they are interacting with each other, leading to specific type of interaction, and leading to a specific type of ecosystem formation, then we term this particular assemblage of species as a community. So for any assortment or for any assemblages of species to be termed a community, it is essential that they should be present together at the same place at a given time, and they should be able to interact with each other. It's not necessary that they are interacting with each other throughout the year or throughout the month, but they should be having sufficient interaction between them for them to be clubbed together as living in the same community. But it is important that they should be living in the same place and also same time. Now, these communities, as I've already discussed earlier in one of my lecture, these are basically described on the basis of a specific type of vegetation which might be present in that particular community. Usually it occurs that we describe any given community in all over the world by the dominant vegetation type which occurs in that community. And as we study community, we can observe different types of patterns which occur in these communities. What are the interactions occurring between different species? What are the growth patterns, and so many other things we can observe if we are going to study a community, that is a field study if we are going to do of a community. Also, there are interactions between individuals of different species when they are present in the same region. Apart from that, as we already know, that individuals of the same species are bound to interact with each other, either for food, either for mating, or various other purposes, for forming a group, and so on. But individuals of different species are also interacting with each other continuously, and this is responsible for formation of specific type of patterns which occur in a given region. Now, what are these different interactions that I am talking about? These interactions, they do not suddenly start occurring on a specific day. It's not that two species come near each other from different region and they start interacting. They might show some interaction, but complex interactions which occur between different species, they have evolved over a long duration of time, and this occurs only when the two species in question, or more species which we are talking about, they have stayed together in that particular place for many years, thousands or millions of years, and they have evolved together. Because they were staying in the same place, they have evolved certain characteristics, and because of these characteristics, they are able to interact with each other in a given manner. It could be one species might be killing other, or they might be competing for the same resource, they might be benefiting each other, or various other types of interaction. But what I want to underline here is that for species to interact deeply or complexly, they should have lived in that particular place for a long duration of time, and they should have evolved over that particular period of time. So the interactions which occur between species in a community, they are basically dependent on evolution, co-evolution of these species, as well as the environmental conditions which are present in that particular region. So these two are important aspects which determine what type of interaction will occur between the species occurring in the given community. Now, these interaction which occurs between the species in a given region, they are often very difficult to define, because these are behavioral patterns, and it might not always be easy to define them or measure them on a given scale. So we have to study them on a large scale and to find out what exactly drive these interaction between different species occurring in a community. Now, as I've already said, that there are a large number of interactions which can occur between species which are occurring in a given region. And what are these classes of interaction? I'll be just be giving a brief description, and then I'll move to predation, which I'll be discussing in detail what exactly happens when a particular species is preying upon other species for its food. Now, why do we need to study interaction? What is the importance of interaction? Why does a field biologist go and study interaction between different species in a community? So basically, these interactions basically are the frameworks which are responsible for setting up a community, describing the character and characteristics of a community. These interactions are very much useful or very much important for forming a community as we describe it, that is assemblage of interacting species. Now, this study of interaction in the field, this helps the scientists to understand what are the basic naturally occurring processes, naturally occurring interaction between species, and it can help in predicting what changes might occur in the community structure if there is any interference by any humans, by human agency, or by newly introduced species in that particular community. Suppose species A and B are interacting with each other, and humans intervene and they start killing species B. Will it affect the population of species A in significant manner? How will we know that? Only when we know what type of interaction occurs between species A and B. Suppose species A and B are competing for the same resource, and by the agency of humans, it happens so that the species individuals of species B individuals are getting killed by humans. What will happen then? Competition between species A and B will lessen over a period of time, and this will help the species A to increase in numbers, because it will not be affected by humans. Only species B is getting affected, their number is getting declined day by day. Similarly, if there is a new species which is getting introduced into a new habitat, what could be the possible effect of that particular species on the entire community structure can be determined or can be found out if we already know the different types of interactions which occur between species in a community. So that is why the studying of the community interaction, that is the interaction between different species in a community, is very much important for a field biologist, and that is why we study different interactions which occur in a community. So basically, whatever interactions we are talking about, right now I'll be talking about interspecific interaction, but we already know that there can be intraspecific interactions also. A very good example of intraspecific interaction is intraspecific competition between individuals of the same species, when the individuals of the same species are competing for the given resource. That is termed as intraspecific competition. So here, what exactly is happening? Individuals which are belonging to the same species, they try to get maximum portion of the same resource, and therefore there is intense competition between individuals. The individual who is superior competitor is bound to get more of the resource. Either it could be food, it could be mate or anything else. And that, therefore, that individual will survive for a longer duration. It will grow fast and it might also be able to produce progeny. Whereas the other individual who is not that superior competitively, that individual might not be getting all these advantages. But right now, I'll be focusing on intraspecific interaction. Now, interspecific interaction, when I say it, means that interaction between individuals of different species. What are the different types of interaction which can occur between individuals of different species? Depending on the habitat, depending on the region or the environmental condition, these interspecific interspecific interaction could be varying from mutualism to amensalism. So there are a large number of interaction which can exist between different species individual. Now, to sum up, what exactly are the different types of interaction which I am talking about? What are they? One is predation, as I will be discussing today about predation, which we all know what exactly is predation. It is basically when a individual of one species eats individuals of other species after killing it. Competition is basically vying for the same resource. When we are trying to get hold of the same resource, either through interference, either through directly interfering with the other individual, preventing that individual from taking that resource, or through indirect competition. Third is mutualism, wherein the two interacting species, they are basically benefiting each other. They are bound to live together with each other. Without each other, they cannot survive. Then we have commensalism and parasitism. So these are other interactions where individuals can harm other individuals in different manners. Or one individual can benefit from other individual while the other individual gets remain unaffected. So coming to predation, which is the topic which I am going to discuss today, what exactly is predation? We all know what exactly predation is, but just to give you a visual representation of what predation means, it is basically eating up of an individual by another individual. So for that, the individual is getting killed, and that individual is then getting eaten by a predator. The individual which is getting killed or getting eaten is known as prey. The individual which kills or which eats other individual is known as predator. And these predator-prey relationships span from invertebrates to highest of the vertebrate, from insects, from arthropods to humans. So we have along all the phyla of the animal kingdom, we can find these interactions which are predator-prey interaction. So herein, the individual which is predator, it will consume a part or all of the another living organism, and then we will be terming this interaction as predation. Now, what are the different types of predation? To ask wholly, if we ask how can there be different types of predation, because predation, as we have already defined it, is eating or consuming a part or whole of the organism, then how can we there be different types? But we have classified different types of predation on certain aspects, and these are basically: first is carnivory. Carnivory, we have been studying from lower grade, from class 1, what exactly carnivores are. Carnivores are those individuals which eat another individual, that is, they eat flesh of another individual, and these individuals are usually consumed directly, that is, predator goes and catches the prey and eats that individual. It could eat it directly on the same day, or it could take a number of days for consuming that individual. So this is termed as carnivory, and the most common example can be lion preying on a deer. That is an example of carnivory. Of course, there are other examples also throughout animal kingdom. There are various examples of carnivore. Then very strange it might sound, but herbivory is also a type of predation. We will term herbivory as predation only if the entire plant material or the plant is killed. Now, if a cow eats only a part of the plant, then we cannot categorize that as predation, because for predation to be an interaction, it is assumed that the individual which is getting preyed upon, that individual gets killed. That means it doesn't have life anymore. But when a cow grazes on a plant and it only eats some of its leaf and leaves the other part of the plant intact, then that cannot be termed as carnivore, cannot be termed as predation. But when a cow or any herbivore eats up the entire plant, uproots it and eats the entire plant, or if it eats the nuts, which are basically seeds and seeds, then it can be termed as predation, because new individuals cannot arise from those individuals, and those individuals which had life in them, they are getting killed by the herbivores. Another type of predation can be categorized as parasitoidism. Now, what exactly is parasitoidism? Herein, predator lives on a host or in a host, inside the host or upon the host, that is on the body of the host, not inside it. And then it eventually kills the host, which it uses as a food resource. So many examples of parasitoidism have been found in the natural world. There are many wasps which lay their eggs on caterpillar of other dipteran insects. So these are parasitic wasps which basically inject or they stick the eggs to the bodies of the caterpillar. When the larvae of the wasp hatch, they start eating up the caterpillar. So it is basically occurring that the larvae of one of the species are eating larvae of another species. So therefore it comes under a types of predation, because entire caterpillar is getting eaten by the larvae of wasp. So here is one example of how a wasp, parasitic wasp, oviposits on the body of a caterpillar, and after the larvae hatches, they eat up the entire caterpillar. And these wasps are basically very much used in integrated pest management, where they lay eggs on the insects which eat up the crops which are grown by humans. Another example is cannibalism, though it is not very different from carnivory. But here one thing different is that individuals of the same species are eating individuals of the same species. In fact, that is, predator is, it belongs to the same species, as well as the prey belongs to the same species. Whereas earlier I said that predation occurs when individuals of one species eat individual of other species, but in this rare type of predation, it's not very rare though, it is very common in natural world, individuals of the same species eating in the another individuals of the same species. So that is cannibalism. Example are tadpoles in pond. It is found in hyena, wolves, dogs and many other organisms. This type of interaction can be seen. This could occur because of paucity of food resources or because of competition. Like in hyena, it occurs because of competition. Whereas in other species, it could be because the food resources are not that abundant and individuals start eating each other. Now, what purpose does the predation serve? Predation, why is it required? Why do animals need to kill other animals and feed on them? Of course, it is because all organisms require energy and nutrient, and that is the primary purpose of predation. The predator kills the prey because it wants to derive energy and nutrients from the prey. So this is the primary purpose. But sidewise, because of predation, the entire community structure and is shaped up, and it leads to evolution of both the predator as well as the prey. Here, what exactly is happening? Predator is killing the prey not because it knows that it is food and it will get energy after eating that, but it doesn't know that because of its predation on the prey, there can be change in the structure of the community, which I've already talked about how key predator can change the entire community structure. So it also leads to change in the community structure, and over a period of time, over 100, over 1,000 or millions of years, both the prey and predator co-evolve. Prey starts evolving defenses and predator starts evolving mechanism to overcome these defenses. So it helps in evolution of the species as well. Though it is very hard to visualize that how can predation lead to evolution of species, but actually it does happen. Now, when we talk of interaction between prey and predator population, we basically talk about how prey number changes the predator number, and how predator number changes the number of prey species. So, before going into that, we should know what exactly a growth equation is. What exactly is the Lotka-Volterra growth equation? Now, the growth equation of a prey population has basically two components. One is the which describes the exponential growth. that is dN by dt is equal to R into N, where R is the natural rate of increase, per capita natural rate of increase, and N is the initial number of the individual. And another is predator induced mortality. Of course, the exponential growth also takes into account the naturally occurring mortality. And then we have predator induced mortality. That is when a prey species is present in vicinity of the predator species, then how does predator species induce death or mortality on the prey species? So if there will be a larger number of predators, then there will be more mortality of the prey. If the predator number is less, then the mortality will be low. So the growth equation for a prey population is dependent on two factors: its natural rate of increase as well as mortality which is getting induced by the predator, that is killing of prey by the predator. So when we talk of exponential growth of prey, as I've already told, dN by dt can be given by the formula R into N prey, where R is the per capita growth rate and N prey is the number of the prey individuals or the prey species individual. Now, the per capita rate at which predator consumes prey is assumed to increase linearly with the number of prey. It is generally assumed that if the number of prey increases in a given community, then more and more will be taken up by the predator in a linear fashion. Now, this particular aspect of linear increase in the consumption of prey by the predator can be represented by C into N prey, where N prey is the number of prey, of course, the number of individuals of prey species, and C is the efficiency of predation. How efficient is a predator individual in catching up the prey species and eating up that species? That is C, which is a constant, and it varies from one individual to one species to another species. Now, the total rate of predation for a given community will be dependent on the number of predator as well as number of prey. So, the total rate of predation, which is basically number of prey captured per unit time, can be derived by formula C, which is the efficiency of predation, number of prey individuals and number of predators. After summing up these two things, the exponential growth and the mortality induced by the predator, we can sum up the growth rate of the instantaneous growth rate of the prey population. It is R into N prey, that is the growth of the prey population minus the mortality induced by the predator. So R into N prey minus C into N pred is N predator is the growth rate of a prey population. Now CN pred into N prey is the mortality which is induced by predator. C is the per capita capture rate, that is the efficiency of predation, and N pred and N prey we already know are the number of predators and prey present in the community, in that particular community. Now, what about predator population? How is predator population affected by the number of individuals of the prey species? We know that a predator will give birth to its young ones, and that will be dependent on the amount of food it will be having, and its food is prey. So, the amount of food the predator is able to consume, that food it will convert either for its growth, its maintenance, or if the food is sufficient in supply, the predator will divert some of the food, some of the energy and nutrients for its reproductive purposes. So, the amount of food which is consumed, it will also increase the amount of individuals which are being produced by the predator. Now, how much amount of food is getting consumed by predator, that can be given by the notation C into N prey into N pred, which is dependent on the predator population as well as efficiency of predation as well as number of prey in the population. But the number of individuals which are being born, that is the birth rate of predator population, is a product of B, which is efficiency with which food is converted into population growth. As I've already said, individuals which are eating food, they divert that for maintenance as well as growth, and if there is surplus, then it is diverted for reproductive purposes. So, B is the efficiency with which the food which is being eaten by a predator is converted to population growth. So, when we multiply this B with C N prey into N pred, that gives us the number of individuals which will be produced by the predator population. Now, predator mortality rate we assume to be a constant because we assume that predator is not being preyed upon by any other predator. But in many cases, it happens that so that predator might be preyed upon by other predator, but that is very rare. Top level carnivores are the one which might eat the bottom level carnivores, but usually the carnivores eat herbivores. So the natural rate of death or the probability of mortality of predators is assumed to be D. So the mortality rate, total mortality rate of that particular population can be given by D into N pred, where D is the probability of mortality and N pred is the population or the number of individuals of predators. So summing this up, the Lotka-Volterra equation for predator can be given as D N pred by dt, that is the change in rate of the population of the predator, is equal to B into C N pred into C N prey, that is the how much food is getting converted by the predator into for the birth of the new individual, minus the natural death rate of the predator individual. So it is B into C N prey into N pred minus D into N pred. Now, B is the efficiency of conversion of prey consumed, I have already told, but I am just repeating that, and C into N and D is the death rate of the predators. Okay, so this gives us the equation for the predator growth rate. Now, these two population are interacting between each other. It's not that they are living in isolation. Prey is getting consumed and predator is consuming the prey. In absence of predator, if there is no predator, what will be the growth rate of prey population? It will be dn prey by dt is equal to rn prey. Already you must be knowing this. Now, as predator population increases, there will be increase in the mortality of prey. If there was no predator, this is the rate of increase of prey population. But if a predator are introduced, how many prey are getting killed by the predator, that will depend on the number of predators. So it might happen that mortality rate due to predation become equal to the growth rate of the prey population. That is, how many individuals, new individuals of prey are getting produced or getting born, that becomes equal to the number of individuals which are getting killed by the predator population. At that instant, dn prey by dt will be zero. That means there will not be any growth in population numbers. Whatever individuals are getting added, they are getting removed also. So dn prey by dt is equal to zero. Now, that will happen if Cn prey into N pred is equal to Rn prey, that is the mortality factor. Cn prey N pred, that is the number of individuals which are getting killed by the predator, is equal to the number of individuals which are getting added by the prey population. Cn prey into N pred is equal to Rn prey. If we solve this equation, we get Cn pred is equal to R, or N pred is equal to R by C. That means if the number of individuals of predators is equal to R, that is the natural rate of increase of prey population, divided by C, that is efficiency of predation, then there will not be any growth in the prey population. This is what this particular notation tells us. If the predator population increases or it is more than R by C, then the growth rate of prey population will decline, because if the predator number starts increasing, then the prey number will start decreasing. But if predator population is less than R by C, then the growth rate of prey population will increase, because the predator number has not reached to such a value that it makes the growth rate of prey population zero. Whereas in case of predator, the growth rate will be zero when rate of the predator increase, that is the number of individuals which are being born, is equal to the rate of natural mortality of the predator. So in this particular case, the two notations which are to be equalized is basically B into C N prey into N pred, which is basically the factors leading to production of new individual, is equal to D into N pred, the factor which tells us about the mortality of the predator population. So this gives us the notation B C into N prey is equal to D, or N prey is equal to D by B C. So the growth rate of predator population will be zero. There will not be an increase in number if the number of prey individuals is equal to D divided by BC. D is the natural mortality rate, B is the efficiency of conversion of the food consumed for production of new individuals, and C is the efficiency of predation. So we can sum this up as, for prey population, N pred is equal to R by C. that is growth rate of prey population is zero when density of predators equals per capita growth rate of prey, that is R, divided by per capita capture rate of predators or efficiency of predation. Any increase in predator density, of course, will lead to a negative growth rate or decline in the growth rate of the population of prey. Whereas for predator population, N prey is equal to D by BC. At this particular number of prey, there is no growth or no increase in the number of predator population. But if there is an increase in the prey population, then there will also be an increase in the predator population. If there is a decrease in the prey population from D by BC, then there will be decrease in predator population also. Therefore, there is a particular interaction between occurring between prey and predators, and this we have given by these two notations: n prey is equal to d by bc, wherein dn predator by dt is equal to zero. When there is no growth in the population, that particular stage is termed as zero growth, and this can be termed as zero isocline, which is a line which shows that there is no increase in the population of given species under a given set of condition that I'll be talking about. Now, the interaction which we have between prey and predator, they can be represented graphically, and in this particular panel it has been represented graphically, wherein on the y-axis is the number of predators and on the x-axis is the number of prey. As we can see, there is a point on the y-axis, that is R by C, which is the predator population below which the prey density will increase, but if the predator number is more than R by C on the y axis, then the prey density will decrease, that is dn prey by dt will become negative. Below this particular line, dn prey by dt is positive, that is prey population will keep on increasing, but this particular line represents zero isocline line, and here the dn prey by dt is zero, that is no growth of prey population occurs if the number of predator is equal to R by C. This can be represented here. Prey increases below R by C line and prey population decrease below above the R by C line, and this is termed as prey isocline. Similarly, if we talk of predator population, we can see here that dn predator by dt is equal to 0 is a zero isocline line for predator at that particular point where number of prey is equal to d by bc. If the number of prey decreases from this particular point, that is d by bc, then the number of predator will also decrease, because the number of prey is not sufficient to sustain a large population of predator. But if the number of prey individuals is much more than d by bc, then the number of predator will also increase, because prey number has increased sufficiently to support a large population of predators. So this is what exactly prey predator interaction tells us: how predator population will decrease and how it will increase, or how prey population will increase or decrease depending on the number of prey population for predator and depending on the number of predator population for prey. So this is complex interaction which occur between prey and predator, and this can be represented in this particular panel here. On the left hand, see if I start from the top left portion, and it is going anticlockwise, as you can see. Here the prey population is very less, as well as predator population is also very low. The prey population starts increasing, represented by plus sign, and predator population, there is a time lag for population of predator to increase, so it is still negative. After some time, when the prey population is increased to a sufficient number, predator numbers also start increasing, which can be seen by plus plus sign in both prey and predator. But when the predator number has increased to a sufficient amount, then they will consume a large number of prey, and therefore prey number will start decreasing, which is represented by prey minus and predator plus in the next panel. And then again, because prey number has decreased sufficiently, the population cannot support the large number of predator population, and therefore predator number also start declining, which becomes prey minus and predator minus. So this keeps on happening. It's also represented by this graph here. There is a time lag in the increase of the prey population and predator population. Predator population always lags behind the prey population in its increase. So one natural example is the cycles which have been studied in tundra region between of the snowshoe hare and lynx. Lynx is the predator hare represented by a red line, and snowshoe hare is the prey which is eaten by lynx. So here we see cyclical pattern of increase and decrease in the population of predator and prey through a large number of years. Now, there are certain characteristic of predation. If a predator is very much efficient, then it will drive its prey to extinction. But if that is so, it means after some time, predator will also get extinct if it is dependent on only one species. So, predator must not be that efficient that it drives its prey to extinction. Also, if this happens, if predator kills most of its prey, then there both the population will move far away from equilibrium, and that will lead to extinction of both the species after some time, because they will not be able to move back to equilibrium. There will be random oscillation and both the species will get extinct. So a very efficient predator is not a good news for its prey as well as for itself. This is one example, laboratory example, where Didynum nasutum and Paramecium coridum were kept together. Didynum nasutum feeds on Paramecium coridum, and it can be seen here that it eats away all the Paramecium coridum, and after some days, because there is no more prey left, it also gets, all the individuals also die. So this efficient predator has caused its own death along with the death of the prey species. Another experiment was done by Huffaker on two mite species, where one was a predator, another was prey, and it was seen that if there were barriers introduced which reduced the dispersal of predator species, then it was seen that both the individuals, both the species could coexist. If there were no barriers, then predator would kill all the prey, but if there were barriers introduced, then predator will be coexisting with the prey species. So these natural things like like refuges, places to hide or barriers, they help predator and prey to coexist together for a long duration of time. Otherwise, all the predators will kill all their prey species, and then themselves they will go extinct. Now, some certain assumptions have been made in the model which I discussed earlier, that predators move at random among the prey. Among the population of prey, which is distributed randomly, that whenever a predator encounters a prey, it will capture it and it will consume it, which you already know it's not always true if you watch National Geographic or Discovery Channel. There are a number of failed attempts of predators for catching the prey. And it says that in absence of predation, there will be exponential growth of prey, which of course it cannot be always true, because there will be intense competition among the individuals of a prey species. And it also says that all the responses will be instantaneous. There will not be a time lag for handling the prey or killing the prey, but that is not so. Handling of prey, searching for prey, and killing and ingesting, all that requires time. So there will be number of time lags. Also important are a structure of predators and prey. If the predators, all the individuals are young ones, they will not be able to catch many prey. And if all the prey species are old or diseased, then they will not give rise to new individuals and prey species will decline. So, a structure of both predator and prey is also very important in describing the interaction. Also, the interaction of prey species with food supply. How good is the food supply for prey? If they are herbivores, then whether the available plant material is sufficient in quantity or not, that is also important to describe interaction between predator and prey as well. Also, the density dependent mortality of predator. If the predator number is very high, then what type of mortality is induced because of the high density of predator? That also needs to be taken into account when we are talking about interaction of predator and prey. Now, one common factor which occurs between the predator and prey when we talk of interaction between prey and predator is we have found C and prey. When we talk for prey is basically the term which talks about mortality of prey individual. And when we talk of predator, if we multiply this term with B, it talks of how much food is getting converted into growth or for production of new individuals. So this term is common for the population of both predators as well as prey. For prey, it will signify death or mortality. For predator, it will signify growth or production of new individuals. Now, through mortality, as I've already said, for prey population, it talks of mortality, and for predator, it talks of talks of growth of production of new individuals. And this happens through two different types of responses of predator individuals to prey individuals. And these two responses have been termed as functional responses as well as numerical responses. Now, when we talk of response, what exactly is response? Response is basically any activity or any action in relation to certain stimulus. When we talk of response of predator, we are talking of, in this particular case, we are talking of what exactly is the activity or response given by predator to any increase in the number of prey population. So, how does it respond? If the prey number prey number increases, in what fashion does the predator modifies its behavior or modifies its physiology to basically relate it to the increased number of prey individuals? Now, talking first of functional responses, what are functional responses? The greater the number of prey, the more the predator eats. This response is basically, it tells us that if the number of prey starts increasing, then the number of prey individuals which are getting killed by a predator also starts increasing. So, more the number of prey, more will be the individuals killed by the predator. So, this relationship is basically the per capita rate of consumption and the number of prey. That is, if the prey starts increasing in number, predator will have more chance to encounter the individuals of prey species, and therefore it will be able to kill more number of individuals of prey species. That is functional response. That is how functional response is defined. Whereas numerical response, it doesn't talk about predator and prey in terms of eating or devouring or killing the prey species. It talks in terms of when the prey individuals numbers increases, how does that lead to a change in the number of the predator individuals? So, it's basically talking about when the prey individuals increase in number, predator individuals, they will also increase in number, and because of greater consumption of prey, there will be sufficient energy left or sufficient resources left for predator to divert for reproductive effort. And therefore, the predator individuals will breed and they will produce young ones, which will lead to an increase in the predator numbers. So, numerical response is basically talking about change in the numbers of predator individuals in relation to change in the number of prey individuals. And for that, we have the term B into C and prey into N prey. So, this is the term which basically defines the numerical response of the predator to change in the prey numbers. Now, apart from the mutual regulation of predator and prey population, we say that there is an interaction between prey and predators, wherein predator kills the prey and prey is getting killed by predator. So, there is a mutual regulation, as I have already shown you earlier in the graph which was displaying population of both predator and prey. How number of preys determine the number of predators, and how the number of predator fashion what will be the number of prey in the time to come, which we saw in the particular graph which was going anti-clockwise, which was showing how predator number increase and decrease along with the increase and decrease in the prey population. But there are certain other important factors also which influence the interaction between predators and prey. Now, what are these factors? These factors, as I told in the experiment of Hofacker, these are cover or refuges for the prey. If the prey are left in open, if they do not have any cover, they will be killed by all the predators, all the prey will be killed, and over time then all the predators will also get killed. But if there are sufficient number of covers or refuges, the places where the prey species can take refuge, then it will modify whatever effect the predator species has on the prey species numbers. Secondly, if the number of prey individuals start decreasing, then it will become more and more difficult for predator to find, to locate those particular individuals and killing them. So, this also modifies the interaction or behavior, the interaction between predator and prey. And third is choice among multiple prey species. If there are a number of species present in a given region which can be fed upon by a predator, then of course, predator will try to find out or to kill that particular species which is more palatable, which gives more nutrition, which gives more energy. But if the number of individuals of such species start declining, that is the species which gives most benefit in terms of energy and nutrient, if their number becomes very less, then predator can move on to other species which might not be that palatable, which might not be that tasty to the predator, which might not give that much energy or that much nutrient, but still they are much more abundant in number, so that predator does not have to make too much of an effort to find those individuals. And therefore, the predator might shift on eating those particular species. So these are some of the additional factors which will influence how the number of population and predator will keep on changing over a period of time. And last is co-evolution. As I've already told you, that two species which are living together, they co-evolve, and more so in the case of predator and prey, because prey species over a period of time, they try to develop defense mechanism or mechanism which will help them to evade predator individuals. But if that keeps on happening and they keep on adding defenses, then predator will not be left with any food. So what does predator do? It also starts evolving in such a fashion that it overcomes the defense mechanism being produced or being evolved by the prey species. So there is a race going on continuously, prey is continuously evolving defense mechanism, and predator is evolving itself to overcome those defense mechanisms. So these factors also play a very important role in prey-predator interaction. Now, as I discussed earlier, the functional response is basically the relationship between the per capita predation rate, that is the number of prey which are getting consumed per unit time by the predator, and the prey population size. That is the functional response. Whereas numerical response was the increase in number of predator species in relation to the prey species. Now, this particular idea of functional response was first introduced by Emmy Solomon in the year 1949. And he described three types of functional responses, basically type 1, 2, and 3. And the type 1, 2, and 3 were described and developed by C.S. Hawling. But the idea was introduced by M.S. Solomon. Now, functional response basically talks about per capita rate of predation, that is instantaneous rate. Now, if the rate of predation, that is the number of individuals which are getting killed, is defined as the number of prey which are eaten by a single predator during a given time TS, then we can say that the rate of predation is equal to C, that is the efficiency of predation, into N prey, the number of prey, into search time, that is the time which is being devoted by a predator to search for prey. For that particular aspect, suppose any individual or any child has one gems, Cadbury gems, then that child will eat that gems immediately. If that child has a packet of gems, that it might happen that the child will cut the packet and eat all of the gems immediately. Okay, depends on the how big the mouth of the child is. But if that child has one eclair toffee, it might eat that toffee complete at one go. But if he or she has a box, then that child will not be able to eat the entire box of toffee at one go. It might be able to eat 5 or 10 at a given time. So what exactly I'm trying to tell here is that there is a limit to the number of individuals which can be eaten by a given species at a given time. But the rate might stay constant. For example, a child can eat 1 out of 1, it can eat 10 out of 10. But if the number of gems is 20, the child might not be able to eat 20 gems. It might only be able to eat 10 out of 20. So for a specific duration, for a specific prey number, the rate is constant for eating, but there comes a time when the rate starts declining and it becomes constant after that. So this basically describes type 1 functional response, wherein what happens is that it is basically a linear response, and it is a relationship between the NE, the number, the predation rate, and N prey during a search time TS. And the proportion of prey population eaten per unit time stays constant in this type of functional response. As I've shown earlier, the number of individuals in the case of gems was eaten by a child was 1 out of 1 or 10 out of 10. But if the number of gems become 20, the child can eat only 10 out of 20. So for a given duration, the rate is constant. After that, it becomes up. It becomes a plateau phase, wherein the rate cannot increase linearly after that. So this is how type 1 functional response can be represented. Here we can see there is a linear increase. After that, it becomes a plateau phase. This is characteristic of passive predators, filter feeders, which are dependent on filtering the water, and they can physiologically take up a given number of individuals at a given time, or passive predators like spiders, which feed on individuals or insects which come and get stuck to their webs, or in predators which do not have sufficient number of prey to feed upon. Then there is another type of response which also takes into account the time which is invested in searching. Type 1 does not take into account the time which is invested in handling. There is another response, type 2, which takes into account the time which is required for handling the prey, because when predator goes for hunting, there is searching of the prey, then handling of the prey. Now, if the TH is the time which is required to handle a prey, then the time spent on handling any number of prey will be any TH. The total time which is invested by the predator is equal to prey search and prey handling will be TS, that is time for search and handling, TH into any. So here we can give TS is equal to total time minus TH into any. Now for total foraging time T, the search time will depend on the time allocated to handling. If more time is invested in handling, less time will be invested in searching. So we can substitute for this TS in the equation, N is equal to C and prey into TS, and we get this particular notation. And if we solve this notation, we come to the final notation, which is NE is equal to C and prey by T divided by 1 plus C into N prey TH. So this gives us another type of graph or another type of response, which is type 2 response, which here can be seen that initially the predator is eating the prey, but the number of prey being eaten by the predator keeps on increasing, but that happens in a decelerating fashion because more and more time is getting invested in handling the prey. So even if the prey density keeps on increasing, time invested in handling is more and more, so that the prey cannot search for more prey over a given period of time when the prey density is very high. If we see in the right panel, we can see the percent of prey consumed per predator per unit time keeps on decreasing as the prey density increases. So this is the type 2 functional response, which is the most common response in the natural world, because it happens because the time invested in handling keeps on increasing with the increase in prey density. And the predation increases up to a maximum rate, and then it assumes a plateau phase. Another type of response is type 3 functional response, which is a sigmoid response. It is also termed as sigmoid response because herein initially the rate of predation is less, and then it accelerates and increases up to a maximum level, and then it reaches a plateau phase. At high density, the response is similar to type 2 response. Initially, when prey are low in number, the consumption is also less, but then it starts increasing as showing a sigmoidal fashion, and then it again achieves the plateau phase. So this is how it's represented. What are the different factors which cause S-shaped response? These are presence of refuges, because the prey species can escape the predator when the prey density is low, and search image and prey switching. Now, refuge I have already discussed. If there are number of hiding places, then prey species can escape the predator, and therefore the number of mortality is less, but it increases if the number of prey species increases and the number of refuges still stay the same. Search image is another aspect which was introduced by L. Tinbergen. He said that if a new species is introduced into a region, then it will not be immediately identified by the predator as a prey. Only when a predator keeps on eating that particular species, that particular predator species will acquire search image. But if the number of prey start decreasing, then that search image will be lost. It will be start fading. Then third is switching. Switching happens when there are more than one species present in a given region, and predator might be having a very strong preference for one species rather than another, and that may depend on the palatability of the species, the energy or resources being derived from the species, or the fact that the number of individuals of that particular species are much more. So initially it might be killing the species which is more palatable, which gives more energy, but later on predator might turn to species which is more in number and less palatable and it gives less energy. So it all depends on the food preference of the predator. So here we can see the light blue line, which shows that there is the expected rate of predation if there is no preference, and the rate of predation which occurs because of switching. When predator switches from one species to another, if its numbers, if the number of second species is quite high. So these all three responses can lead to, these three factors can give rise to the type 3 functional response. So this is a notation of different types of functional responses. Type 1 we can see linear, type 2 we can see it is increases in a decelerating fashion, and type 3 is sigmoidal. It basically is less at beginning, starts in that it starts increasing, then it comes to a plateau phase. And if we represent it by percent of prey consumed, we can see it, in different types of lines how the prey number will change with the predator number. So these are some example, linear type 1, that is type 1 functional response. Mortality of prey is dependent on the number of individuals of prey. Second is the time needed to kill the prey, it's limiting because more of the time is invested in handling. And third is sigmoidal type, wherein all the factor of refuse, search, image and switching come into play. Then another type of response is numerical response. As I've told earlier, numerical response could be because of increase in number by reproduction, by production of more and more babies, or it could be because of aggregation of predator species to patches where more prey species, prey individuals can be found. So either predators reproduce more, producing more and more individuals, or they move into area where the prey density is very high. This particular aspect is termed as aggregative response, when predator species move to area where prey number is very much high, and therefore the predator number also increase. And second is reproductive effort. In this panel we can see that there are two types of individuals, rodents and weasels. The graph which is representing the population of weasel species is basically it's correlated with the number of individuals of the weasel species. As the number of rodents increase over a period of time, it is followed by increase in the number of weasel species, because weasel feeds on this particular rodent species. So this is increased reproductive effort, and that's why the number of predator is increasing. Secondly is aggregative response, where predator go and they basically localize, or they aggregate in the area where more and more prey individuals can be found. So it can be seen here, there is one bird known as red shank, and they feed on corophium. As the number of corophium per meter square increases, it is seen that red shank individuals go and basically migrate, and they locate to that particular region, and they start eating the corophium or corophium species. So this is a type of aggregative response. So all in all, we can see that numerical response could be because of increase in the reproduction rate, or because of aggregation of predator species to patches where prey are very high in number. So this sums up our interaction between predator and prey species, how predator and prey species interact, and how their number changes over a period of time. Thank you.
With this note, thank you, sir. Thank you so much for giving us this session. Friends, do write to us at info.cec@nic.in if you have any question in mind. We are taking your leave with the promise that we are going to meet again soon. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you once again.